Hachette Audio presents. Don't Forget Us Here. Lost and Found at Guantanamo. Written by Mansoor Adayfi in collaboration with Antonio Aiello. Read by Roxanna Hope Radja.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Sisters, brothers, and friends. This is Mansoor Adayfi. You can call me 441 or Smiley Troublemaker. I am the author of Don't Forget Us Here. Thank you so much for listening to my story. I think you will like it a lot. When you start listening, you might ask yourself, why is a woman reading Mansoor's story? Remember, this is the upside-down world of Guantanamo, where the iguanas talk, the sea whispers, and nothing makes sense. So why should this, and why not? But really, let me explain. All my life I have suffered terrible mistreatment at the hands of men. It was men who kidnapped me in Afghanistan, men who tortured me, men who ran the camp. As you will hear in this story, things always go better when women are involved. So I felt strongly that my story should be voiced by a woman. Roxanna Hope Radja has done a beautiful job, and I am grateful to her for reading my story. I wish you the best of luck on your journey through Guantanamo. You are not alone. Please fasten your seat belts and let us fly. I am with you all the way. Thank you.
To my parents, Amina and Ahmed, all my sisters, especially Yumna Desai, my Guantanamo brothers, and my lawyers, Aunt Beth and Andy Hart. Preface. Nearly 20 years after Guantanamo opened, people are still debating whether or not such a place should continue to exist. Imagine if American boys, 18 years old or even younger, had spent 5, 10, 20 years in a foreign prison without being charged with a crime, where they were tortured, punished for practicing their religion, experimented on, and forced to live in solitary confinement. This is Guantanamo. Between January 11, 2002, and now, the United States has held 779 prisoners at Guantanamo. Those men have been from all over the world, representing 50 nationalities and speaking more than 20 languages. They have been doctors, journalists, singers, professors, students, teachers, paramedics, poets, blacksmiths, former CIA spies and assassins, farmers, tribal elders, and so much more. They have been sons and husbands, brothers and fathers. They are the reason I wrote this book. I never set out to write a book about myself. I instead wanted to tell the story of Guantanamo and of all the men who have been imprisoned there, to show the world what life was really like, to show the world who was really there. I thought that if I could capture all the small moments of joy and beauty, of friendship and brotherhood, of hardship and the struggle to survive, all the moments that united us and bonded us, that I could maybe change the way people thought about Guantanamo. I thought it was important to capture these moments and to tell them from our point of view, the way we experienced them. These are important stories to tell, and I didn't want them told by someone else who didn't live them with us. In 2010, when I was transferred for the first time to communal living, I started writing those moments down. I talked to my brothers, and together, we remembered what had happened to us. As I wrote these stories down, I called them Moments from Guantanamo, and I sent them as letters first to my attorney, Andy Hart, and then in their entirety to my attorney, Beth Jacob. I wrote the stories as accurately as I could. We didn't have clocks or watches for years, so the first drafts of Moments from Guantanamo were unanchored in time, just like we were. But even though we had lost track of time and our connections to the outside world, we remembered what happened to us. I have changed some names and details to protect the identities of the brothers, guards, and camp staff. In 2018, I started working with Antonio Aiello to turn my Moments from Guantanamo into a book. We spent hundreds of hours on Skype calls, going through my letters and manuscripts, reliving my time at Guantanamo, anchoring my stories in time and place, and threading them all together as a narrative. It was hard reliving those years and processing what happened to me. Sometimes I remembered something new and became depressed. Sometimes I got frustrated with Antonio for asking me the same questions over and over again until he finally understood an important moment. Many of us suffer from bouts of PTSD, and years of living with harsh, bright lights damaged our eyes and left us with crushing headaches. All of this can make it hard to work. Sometimes I just wanted to quit and forget the book even existed so that I wouldn't have to go back to Guantanamo. I never intended to write the book as my story. It was always supposed to be about all our stories. It was supposed to be the story of Guantanamo. But I realized that by telling my story, I was able to tell the larger story of Guantanamo and the stories of all my brothers, so that the world would experience our Moments of Guantanamo together with us. Guantanamo still haunts me, and I still live every minute of my life with the stigma of being a Guantanamo detainee. I hope that by completing this book and sharing it with the world, I can begin to quiet those ghosts and chip away at the stigma. I hope that people begin to understand who we really are. I believe art and storytelling are how we take people on journeys into our souls. Please allow me to take you on a journey through Guantanamo. Buckle up and prepare yourself. I will be your guide, but don't worry, you won't have to wear the orange jumpsuit, shackles, or hood. You will be free every night to leave behind the fences and isolation cells and rejoin your life. But I think you will come back and join me again to see a side of Guantanamo few people have experienced. Where, yes, there is much pain, but there are also unexpected moments of beauty and joy that will take your breath away. This is my Guantanamo. Part 1. Arrival. Chapter 1. I waited in darkness for death. The interrogators were done with me. "You aren't valuable enough to keep alive," they said. I didn't have the intelligence they wanted on Al-Qaeda's chain of command. They bound my hands with duct tape, then taped my eyes and ears. They taped my mouth and then pulled a hood over my head. They dragged me outside into the cold and forced me to my knees. I hadn't seen the light of day in weeks, and I thought I would never see blue sky again. I'd been kept hooded or inside dark rooms, stripped naked and beaten bloody for, I don't know how long, weeks, a month, maybe more. I was in Afghanistan, but I didn't know where. If I hadn't lived it, I wouldn't have believed what happened to me. It happened so fast and none of it made sense. It all started days before I was supposed to return home to Yemen, when my friend and I were ambushed on the highway in northern Afghanistan and kidnapped by warlords. At first, they just wanted our truck and to ransom us for money. I grew up in a tiny village in Yemen that had no electricity or running water. I had been told all my life that I was smart. I was 18 and full of the stubborn confidence boys can have at that age. I'd never been in a situation I couldn't talk myself out of. None of that mattered when the United States started bombing and dropping leaflets offering reward money for Al-Qaeda and Taliban fighters. The warlords got a better price selling Arabs to the Americans. The warlords told me to say that I was Al-Qaeda or the Americans would kill me. The Americans told me they knew I was an Al-Qaeda leader, a recruiter, a middle-aged Egyptian, and all I had to do was admit it. None of it was true. Waiting on my knees to be executed, I wished that I could see my mother one last time to say goodbye. I regretted my sins and the mistakes I'd made, and I prayed to Allah to forgive me, wishing that I was closer to him and had done more good deeds in my life. One day we all will stand before him. He knows I haven't wronged these people who tortured me. He knows I have caused harm to no one. A man cried close by. He begged someone to stop beating him. He begged for his life. This wasn't new. In the endless darkness, I'd heard women and children beg too. A soldier yelled, and then there was gunfire, but it wasn't for me. My heart pounded through my temples. I cried. Where would the bullet hit me? Would they shoot me in the head? In the chest? Would I feel pain? The rest of my life existed in these seconds and no more. I prayed again to Allah. I wished I wasn't so cold. Allah, Allah, I bear witness that there's no deity but Allah. I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Allah, oh Allah. I told myself that I would be strong when they came for me. I'll make them work. I won't walk. So they dragged me, my toes digging into the dirt. Allah, Allah. They threw me to the ground and tore off my clothes and stripped me naked. They searched me in the worst way, and what did they think they would find after I had been tortured and left naked for months? They pulled a hood over my head.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.